Philadelphia is always right there, and this, I think, had the opportunity to put us up over that level and didn't quite get it done.
But, I mean, if you look at it, I mean, it went off without a hitch. I mean, there were only, what, a couple instances of where they actually took people into custody.
That's very
true. One guy was, like, asking, like, all details about the Pope's schedule, and they thought it was a little suspicious, so they just took him in for questioning. One guy, I think, tried to jump over a fence with a backpack, and so they decided to question him further. Then one guy tried to bring drugs in, so they took him away. But if those were the only three incidents, then, I mean...
We did pretty well.
I think it was still a success. Mm-hmm. I mean, I really do. Just looking at the pictures, I mean, I don't think we needed 1.5 million people here to consider it a success. I mean, I think any number... I mean, there was a large crowd there. We don't know what the number is, but there was a large crowd there. And they were there to see the Pope, and they, you know, a large majority of them got to do that. Mm-hmm. But then there was also a large majority that, you know, security got backed up a little bit, and they actually couldn't make it through security to see the Pope. So they came all that way, and then they were stopped at security.
That's very sad.
Yeah, some people said it took them hours upon hours just to get through security to see the Pope. And I actually had heard a story that I just thought this was interesting. One guy went through... 5 miles or like a mile worth of security, realized he forgot his wallet at one of the checkpoints, but he turned around, walked all the way back, and this was the cool thing. His wallet was still there.
Oh, wow.
That's wonderful.
After about half an hour of waiting in line, his wallet was still sitting in the exact same spot.
That will never happen to him again.
No, and I mean, it's probably a little bit of the influence of, you know, the event going on that day, but I thought that was just really cool.
That's very nice.
Yeah, and, you know... There's another part of people that said, you know, why were we the only city that had a mass outside? Would it have been better for us if we had had it at the Link or at Citizens Bank Park or something like that? We sold tickets. It's in an enclosed area. There's already preset parking. They're used to handling big events. The Wells Fargo Center could have been there. They're used to handling event traffic for concerts, the Eagles games, Phillies games. Some people said that that might have been a better option than just opening up the parkway to anybody who wanted to come and say, all right, first come, first serve, file in.
That's very true.
So I don't know. I mean, I don't know. The Link can hold 69,000 people.
Right.
So, I mean, whether or not there were more than 69,000 people on the parkway yesterday or on Sunday. I don't know, but at least they would have. I think it's interesting to think about having it in an enclosed space, just because everybody's in the same spot. You can buy tickets for wherever you want, and then, you know, you have a good view. I mean, from everywhere, because it's like designed to be like a stadium. You set it up in a certain way where everybody can see, and I don't know, because if you're at the back of the parkway. I mean, you're looking at a Jumbotron.
Yeah, it's like made in America all over.
Yeah. Whereas if you're at the top of the Link, at least you can actually see something.
That's very true. That's a good point. I think most of it was just to try and have the ability, because you can't set a number of people that are standing outside. Like, it was to, I think it was to have the, to make sure that A, as many people could see the Pope as possible, and B, without a limit on ticket sales, the ticket sales prices could be lower, as well as it could bring in the city more money since there was no, since there would be no cap on it.
Yeah, and, you know, that's something, you know, you do, you live and you learn, and you maybe, you know, if it happens again, I mean, because this isn't the first time that the Pope has come, maybe next time, you know, they say, all right, we'll do this differently. But a lot of people were critical of how much security was there, but then the Secret Service basically just said that that's kind of just like the nature of the beast, that there needed to be that much security there, just because of the event that it was. But, I mean, I think the people that went out to see him just genuinely enjoyed being out. Like, I don't know. I haven't read anything yet where it talked about people who were, like, angry. When they came out there, they're like, oh, I had to wait in line for 2 hours to go through security, and then it took me another hour and a half to walk down the parkway, and then I finally got my spot, and then I had to wait 5 hours for the Pope actually to come out. I've been awake since 4 a.m.
Yeah, you know, these people knew what they were getting into, probably, going into the... And They expected that because this is a high security event.
Yeah.
Just because of it's probably the same for like the inaugural address, all that kind of stuff. They have to go through all those security measures. And this is guy not living in our nation, but visiting our nation. So they want to keep it extra safe, in order to keep like, you know, name of not only the city but the nation in good being.
Yeah.
So I agree with it, but yeah, the security, waiting for security. I mean, it's just a small price to pay for being there and experiencing this.
And then, I mean, we're just talking about the one aspect of it on Sunday. I mean, he was also here Saturday when he spoke at Independence Mall about immigration. And the one thing that I thought was really cool about that was he spoke from the same lectern used by Abraham Lincoln when he delivered the Gettysburg Address.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. That's a pretty historical.
Yeah.
Pretty cool historical.
So he was up there in front of Independence Hall speaking from the same wood lectern that Abraham Lincoln used, which I thought was fascinating.
You think they pulled that out of the Smithsonian or something?
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's on display at Independence Hall.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Wow.
And there were lots of people that lined up for that. They lined all the way up back to the Constitution Center. So there were like a lot of people that showed up for that. Now that one you had to have a ticket as opposed to the mass where you could just show up.
Okay.
But I know that on Saturday, Patco was saying that they saw lower than expected turnout and that they were going to stop running their express trains and turn them into local trains. So when I saw that, I was like, whoa, like what's going to happen here? Is this just going to be a big bust and like no one's going to show up? Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, you start looking at social media on Sunday morning, and they're saying, you know, where it was a 35 minute wait for security on Saturday, it's now a 2.5 hour wait, and I'm like, yes, finally, yes, the people are coming.
Yeah.
Because you know, there was a lot of work that went into this, and I wanted. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'd be lying. I wanted 1.5 million people to show up.
I thought that would be pretty cool.
That's historical, right there.
Yeah. But then I also feel the pain of all the restaurant owners who stocked up on all this food and nobody came.
Yeah.
There were articles about these people who said that they bought all this food, all this extra food, and they had people literally come to the front of the restaurant and then just keep walking down the street. Like they didn't actually come and eat. They came to see the Pope. They bought a bag of chips or whatever. And then they went home.
Exactly. And knowing people here on campus that live in the local or the surrounding area and have jobs, a lot of people as like wait staff were expecting huge amounts of money from this weekend from tips and things. And so many people, like they said, they were just so overstaffed because no one was coming in to eat. Nobody was trying to.
Which is really a shame. Yeah, because they expected a huge economic boom from this thing. But when people don't come and spend money, then it like takes away from like another beneficial aspect that the city was looking forward to. I mean, because they're paying $12 million for this. But, I mean, who knows what the benefit coming back to them was. Because a lot of the hotel rooms, I think, were rented out by people in the media.
Right.
I mean, you're looking at different broadcasts that they're doing. I think 6ABC may have been at the top of Embassy Suites. Right there on the parkway, and they were in like a little balcony that overlooked that. I know Adam Joseph was in; he was staying in some people's houses in Fairmount and reporting from their rooftop decks and from their balconies. And so I think actually the people who rented out their homes, I think, did the best.
Yeah, I agree. That's pretty smart. That's a good idea.
Yeah, because then they're like, "Ooh, like look at this home. I can live in a house. I don't have to stay in a hotel room."
Exactly.
Like, check this out. But all in all, I think it was a successful event that many people really appreciated. I thought it was just I watched it on TV. I watched a couple of things on TV, and I thought that it was just cool to see him interact with all the different people when he got off the airplane and he blessed the boy who was in the wheelchair.
Yep.
Who was right there with the band. I just thought it was very just kind of touching, and it was like, wow, like. He's really in Philadelphia. He's like really like doing this right now. And then when he went to the prison, when he went to Kern Fromhold up in Northeast Philadelphia, and the prisoners actually built him like his own chair.
Wow.
Yeah. So just in like a wood shop, they put together parts for a chair and they made it for him. And he met with them and he said he told the prisoners not to believe the lie that nobody can ever change.
Right.
that we're all on a path, different path in our lives, and that, you know, this is just the path in their life, but that they can go and make themselves better. I don't know.
That's
I was just watching, and I was just like, wow, like, this is, like, really cool. And, like, I didn't need to be there to hear it. Like, I you know, I watched it on TV, and I got the same effect as if I was...
Right.
You know, if I was there and I could just, like, sit on my couch and hear the same message.
Which is what, like, I don't know, I thought, and I'm sure the city thought, that people from all around the country, but even more specifically, like, Pennsylvania and, like, the surrounding suburbs and neighborhoods would come out to see the Pope. And I think because TV is so, because you can get such a great experience from just sitting on your own couch and watching TV, that it's not so bad, that it might not be worth it to make the trek down and to stand in line in security to rather than be in the comfort of your own home in your pajamas watching Pope Francis. Like,
yeah.
So, I don't know. That's just a thought.
All right. Well, we are going to take a quick break, and then we'll be right back here talking about some more issues, some more news that's going on today. You are listening to Rational Radio on Philly's number one college radio station.
This is Jeff, the Metal Mailman, and you're locked into the Simply Sinister Show with RC.
Teenage wasteland, oh yeah.
What's going on, everybody? You are listening to Rational Radio on Philly's number one college radio station. Continuing to talk the day's big headlines here on WHIP Radio. If you want to give us your take on anything that we're talking about right now, the number is 215-204-WHIP. Now we are moving on to something else, some kind of world news going on. The UN General Assembly is going on right now in New York City, so a busy time for them since they just had the Pope, and now they're moving into General Assembly. And yesterday Obama and Putin met for the first time formally in 2 years. And they were talking about issues ranging from ISIS to what the best plan of action going forward is in regards to Syria and the rebels that are fighting there in the government of Bashar al-Assad. And the meeting was said to be productive. According to the article on NBCNews.com, Putin told reporters that we have a lot in common, referring to President Obama. While disputes remain, he said that we have sound ground to work on the points of concern together. And so one of these points of concern is the fighting of ISIS, Russia saying that they want to take the lead and start fighting ISIS themselves. Should we let them do that? Should we let them go ahead and take the lead?
I mean, honestly, like, I'm surprised. I'm honestly very surprised that Obama discussed anything with Putin over the whole Crimea thing and everything. But I think Putin is right in that we are very, not very similar countries, but similar countries. We're both very military-minded. I think that's usually the first thing that comes to mind. As well as neither of us really like ISIS. Both had a significant part in creating ISIS in the first place, with the whole Cold War, and this is a spinoff from that. So I think it is both our responsibilities as well as the rest of the world's responsibility to make sure ISIS doesn't gain any more ground.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting proposition that they had that says we want to take the lead on this. And I think if they're saying that, I'd say, why not? Let them go do it. Let them go fight ISIS.
Yeah.
I mean, our plan against ISIS, I don't know if it's been working because there's still...
That's our plan. We have really, really no plan except go and kill them.
Right.
Try to kill as little civilians as possible.
Exactly, because we're still having the debate about whether we need boots on the ground or not. Whereas over in Russia, they're like, we're ready to go. Let's go. We're going to fight them. And so I think if they want to take the lead on it, let them do it. Who knows? Maybe this can be some common ground that the U.S. and Russia can agree on. Obama calls up Putin. He says, all right, Vlad, listen up. Here we go. I like what you're doing. I like what you're doing over there. And he says, thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. I'm glad you approve. I'm glad that I am finally, you know, making some progress over here.
You know, this is verbatim, right? Yeah.
This is actually what they said. I was actually listening to that phone call. Trying to impersonate them as best as I can. But I think absolutely, if they're showing some initiative with this, just because there's been so much hostility after the whole Ukraine situation with Russia and the U.S., I think if there's an area that we can agree on and find some common ground, let them go fight ISIS. Let them do that. If they want to contribute the bulk of the money to their troops and weapons, and let them spend their money. We'll save some money in the Defense Department.
And we can keep doing exactly what we've been doing. If Russia takes the lead, we'll be as effective as we were before when Russia's sending kids over. So.
And we'll still tell people that we're doing a good
exactly.
job.
Exactly.
U.S.-led coalition today eliminates
exactly.
three ISIS targets. Yeah, and that'll still be on the news. And, I mean, are we, as of right now, I think we're just using drones over there. I think that's all that we're doing.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is interesting.
Some guy at a military base with a big remote controller. So
yeah, there you go.
Taking out ISIS.
Yeah, I don't know. It just needs to stop. Mm-hmm. Them beheading people for their religion and destroying ancient artifacts and temples and all this stuff. You watch the video and in a matter of minutes the thing is to the ground.
Yeah, it's scary.
And
it's
we're literally watching this, and this is why can't we do anything? We are the most powerful country in the world, and we can't stop this.
Exactly. But at the same time, is it our issue? Is it something that we need to get involved with? So that's the constant right. debate that we have, where we can be stopping it if we really concentrate our efforts. But do we have A, better things to worry about, or B, the need to do anything? So
should it be our job to do it? Should the U.S. be the global police force? No, should not be the global police force. Do we have a responsibility to do something? Yes. If you look around the country, I don't see much initiative from any other country interested in ending what they are doing right now. No one else. I don't see, you know, the same enthusiasm coming from David Cameron of England or Angela Merkel of Germany saying, yes, let's go, move, move, move. We are going to take these people out. Whereas you have President Obama who's up there, I vow to bring an end to ISIS and all of the atrocities that they've committed. A little bit more conviction from David Cameron than Angela Merkel, because they have had one of the people beheaded was from England. And then you have James Foley, who's from the United States. So I think based on that, I think we have we have an interest in ending what they're doing. I mean, I don't see why anybody else doesn't say, look at this, and just with a reasonable mind say, this needs to stop.
Exactly.
Like, why? But then it's always us. I mean, why? It's always the United States that goes and does these things and then gets involved in these conflicts and then can't get out of these conflicts.
And then has to loop other countries into it to help pull us out. Exactly. And I think that if we have dubbed ourselves as the world police, something we can do is subcontract and delegate it out to Russia. If they're willing to do it, like, by all means, take the lead.
Yeah.
Finish
it. I mean, we can't get a coalition together anymore because they're so scared this is going to turn into another Iraq or Afghanistan.
Exactly.
I mean, look at the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. I mean, it's easy to say, looking back on it now, after however many billions of dollars were spent on it and however many lives lost, saying that we shouldn't have gone in. I mean, it's easy to say that in hindsight now, but I mean, you look back at it, and it was based on faulty intelligence,
right?
And that's it.
Right.
And now we have a very unstable Middle Eastern region, and now we kind of have to fix. Now it's our job to fix it.
It's scary to watch.
It is scary
it's
to watch. Absolutely.
To see happen.
Because we're looking at this, and it's falling apart right in front of. I mean, ISIS, they're a rogue group of individuals. You don't know when they're going to do something.
Exactly.
Every other day they're putting up a propaganda video on YouTube trying to get people to join. You hear all the time now in the United States about arrests that have been made in connection to ISIS. And some of the kids who were arrested 15, 16 years old. Like, and they're saying that they're radicalized because of ISIS videos that they're watching on YouTube.
Yeah. No, they're appealing to the kids, and that's scary. I don't think anyone could ever come into America and take us over by force, because we have all of the Americans. But
yeah.
I think they could come in and from the inside out, change hearts and minds and beat us. It's terrifying to think of.
Yeah. Another scary thing is that they're using our weapons. All the stuff that we left in Iraq and Afghanistan, that's our stuff that they're now killing us with.
Exactly. And they're winning.
Yeah.
They're 100% winning right now, because we're doing nothing about it.
Yeah, because we don't know how, like,
we have no idea how to respond to it. So.
And why is that the case? I mean, we see what they're doing. Why don't we make a decision on something to do? I mean, we say, all right, we're going drones. Okay, we're going to just do it from the air. We're going to just... I mean, how can that be an effective strategy? You're looking at something from the sky.
Right.
I mean, there needs to be some sort of boots on the ground advisory something or other that's looking at what's actually happening and then radio back saying, oh yeah, in so-and-so town, you know, I think we should probably call in an airstrike over here. Okay, cool, sounds good. And some sort of coordination, but now it's like, all right, track these people, know where they are, spend all the time doing that, then we'll hit them with the airstrike. And just the, I mean, Obama has to keep getting authorization from Congress to spend more and more to do all these actions. I mean, he doesn't want to declare war on them, because then that's just bringing us back into another Middle East conflict right after we just got out of our last Middle Eastern conflict. But at the same time, the people, every time one of these videos surfaces of them beheading someone, the American people are like, we need to do something. And exactly. He says, we're going to do something. And now we look at it and say, nothing has
been
done.
What are we doing?
Right. What are we doing other than, you know, airstrikes, which, I mean, I don't know how effective they've been overall.
I mean, I'm sure they're effective to some extent, but I think there's a whole lot more that we can be doing. But we just need to determine whether or not this is... I think we need to decide either to be 100% involved in this or 0% involved in this. I don't think there's a whole lot of middle ground on this issue. So
I'd agree with that, because I think in the middle ground, it's like, well, you know, I don't know how much involved we want to
exactly.
be. Like, all right, we're going to be 50% involved. Well, now what is 50%?
Yeah, what does that mean?
Like, come on, like... And then, I think it's either all or nothing. When you have a country like Russia, how about you say, Russia, take the lead and we'll be there to support you? Because then
we'll back you up.
Right. Then you have the cooperation between the two countries.
But at the same time, we're forming an alliance with Russia, who just all of a sudden randomly decides to invade other countries. So
yeah. So then there's that part of it. You have to look at it and say, well, we're going to ally ourselves with them.
Yeah.
But they are taking the lead. But they just disregarded the liberty of that other country.
It's shaky ground we're working on.
Yeah. And then it's a hot topic for all the people running for president right now, always coming up at the debates, asking what they would do if they were president, and how they would eliminate ISIS. I mean there's been talk about assembling an alliance with the Kurds and with the Turks, saying people who actually form an alliance with the countries in that region who have an actual vested interest in the stability of the region.
But here's what happens every time we do that. We form an alliance with these anti terrorist groups. Let's say in the Cold War, we train them, we give them weapons, and then all of a sudden they start doing bad things. So we come in, we fight them, try and eliminate them, and then all of a sudden here they come back again. The same, or the group we trained to fight, the group that we originally trained, is now fighting us. And so it's just a vicious spiral that we need to figure out how to get ourselves out of.
Yeah, so hopefully we can figure out some sort of strategy soon. But I think interesting developments coming out of the UN General Assembly, President Putin meeting with President Obama in regards to lots of topics going on in the world right now, one of them being ISIS, saying Russia wants to start taking the lead. So we'll be back after a quick break. Keep it tuned here to Rational Radio on WHIP, Philly's number one college radio station.
Okay, forest animals, today is a new day. Kids are coming to the forest, and it's up to us to make their visit a good one. Sparrow.
Yes?
Have you practiced the most popular bird songs for the year?
Of course.
Catchy. I like it. Okay, river.
Dude.
How's the temperature?
It's a refreshing 52 degrees, man. Perfect for a little riverside shoeless relaxation.
Ah, good. Owl, you here?
Of course.
Who's asking? I am. Look, you know the drill. Sleep during the day, scare the kids at night.
Perfect. I love my job.
Oak tree?
Sup?
Still in the same place I left you last year. That's what I like. Consistency.
Well, it's not like I'm going anywhere for the next couple hundred years.
I know. I love it. Turtle. Turtle.
He's not here yet, man.
He's late every morning. You'd think he would have learned by now to leave the night before our meetings. Okay. Squirrel. Has anybody seen Mr. Squirrel?
The forest has been preparing just for you. Visit a forest near you today. To learn more about cool things to do in the forest, visit discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
August.
This thing that official. Believe we had a great night, but I ain't the type to tell you that I miss you. You don't like that I make this easy. Leave it after sexing on the floor. Baby, I know you need me like I need you, but I'm not the one you
just drank a couple drinks with him like me. You'll probably go insane with him like me. Let's just party till we can't. Ain't no loving me. And I'm the one to blame. Ain't no loving me. So don't come looking for love.
Number one college radio station, WHIP, Rational Radio.
Welcome back, everybody, to Rational Radio. We are talking about the day's biggest stories here on Philly's number one college radio station. And we are moving in now to something that came up a little bit ago, a little this morning. And it is in regards to Paul Walker, who's the actor behind many of the Fast and Furious movies. And his daughter is now suing Porsche, claiming that the sports car that her dad was in when he was killed suffered from numerous design defects. This, according to the Association Associated Press. The suit claims that the car, which was marketed as a street-legal race car, lacked a proper stability control system and safeguards to protect occupants and keep it from catching fire after a collision. So, researching online, Paul Walker was going about 90 miles an hour in a 45 zone when his car kind of when it spun out and then caught fire, killing him and the passenger in the car. And now his daughter is suing Porsche, saying that it was the car's fault, that it was the defects on the car that caused his death, not anything else.
Right. So, quick fact check. It's not the lawsuit isn't by his daughter. She's only 16. It's on behalf. I'm not sure exactly who it is doing it, but it's on behalf of the 16-year-old daughter. But she, I don't know. To me, I think it's hard to argue that it's the car's fault when he was clearly going double the speed limit.
Right.
So, like, I don't know. Just for me, it's difficult. It's obviously a very tragic accident. Paul Walker was a very highly acclaimed actor, and he had a lot of great movies. I personally have never watched any of the Fast and Furious movies.
Neither
have
I.
It's on my wish list on Amazon. I think it's a very sad situation, but there were circumstances that made it very clear that it is not the car's fault, regardless of whether or not the car was or was not supposed to catch on fire after. He was doing the wrong thing when it happened. So
yeah, I mean, he was going almost double the speed limit, and now she's saying, now this lawsuit is saying that that no, actually it was the car's fault. It shouldn't have caught on fire. Not the speed. No. It wasn't that he was going too fast. It was that, well, you know, there was a little defect with the car. Which is kind of confusing. Because I don't know how he died almost 2 years ago, and now she's saying that, oh, I think it's the car's fault.
Exactly. So I'm looking at the website, and it says, CNN says that it was between 80 and 93 miles per hour was how fast the vehicle was going on an office park road, so a business complex, just flying through, and that the lawsuit is in regards to it says autopsy blames impact and fire for actor Paul Walker's death. So yes, the car... Maybe it's a problem with the car, that specific car, or the whole fleet of models. But
yeah,
I don't know. To me, there isn't a whole lot of weight to this lawsuit.
Yeah, because I mean, I feel like if you're a company like Porsche and you're making racing cars, I feel like you've done enough testing.
Exactly.
I mean, now there are always the things that, you know, you have recalls and parts that, you know, go bad, and sometimes, you know, the design isn't exactly what you thought it would be. And then, you know, you have to make those adjustments, but I feel like they've been making cars that go really fast for a really long time.
Very long time.
And I'm just thinking, you think there are people that go that fast on Broad Street right outside Temple?
I'm 100% sure that happens at least once a day. Someone flies through.
Okay. Cause that's, so I'm thinking about this, right? You know, this is, I mean, essentially what he was doing, it was street racing. I mean, that's what that car is made to do.
Exactly.
I'm thinking about the couple times, you know, when I walk outside on Broad Street, of all the people that fly down Broad Street, especially at night. Not so much during the day, because there's a good amount of traffic up
there.
I'm talking about, like, you know, 9:30 at night. There are some people that fly down there that are definitely not just like, hey, I need to get where I'm going quickly.
Right.
It's definitely like, hey, buddy, next to me, you know, help me play a little game here.
Guess how loud and fast my car is.
Right. And I think those cars, I've never seen one of them catch on fire.
Exactly. Yeah.
I bet there's street racing that goes on.
I'm sure, especially where in North Philadelphia, I'm sure there's racing going down. But I think the argument is that it didn't catch on fire while he was driving. It was after the accident. I just can't justify it in
yeah.
my mind.
I mean, once you're in an accident, I mean, that's like a serious, how, I, is there, I mean,
it stinks if your car does catch on fire after an accident, but I feel like, you know, with so much, I mean, if you're going that fast and you hit a strong stationary object, right, how can you say, I mean, yeah, cars are made not to catch on fire, but I mean, if you are moving at a very high rate of speed and then all of a sudden you hit something and, you know, you dent the whole front end of your car, you hit the side of your car really hard, I mean, I how can you say for certainty? I don't think if you're a car manufacturer, you can say when you put out a car 100% without any doubt in the world, this car, there will be nothing that happens to it. If you're in an accident, because I feel like once you get in an accident, you know, all bets are off. You just hope you can get out alive from an accident.
Yeah, there's always that plus minus on the car certainty. But the lawsuit is saying that the impact of the crash, he survived, the passenger. Oh, I forgot his name. It starts with an M. But the passenger did not survive the crash, was killed on impact. But the driver, Paul Walker, survived the crash and was killed in the fire after. But I don't know. To me, regardless, it's a very sad situation.
Yeah.
Regardless. You just can't be flying down double the speed limit.
Yeah.
Like, that's not an acceptable...
No.
That's not acceptable behavior.
It's not something smart to do either.
Exactly.
Unless acceptable, I mean, illegal.
Right, right.
But, I mean, I think there's a big... I mean, if we look at the broader picture of this, I think street racing is a big culture. And I don't know. I think that a lot of these people who are into street racing and have tons of money... and buy these really nice cars, expect them to dominate everything all the time, and then that doesn't happen.
Right. I think there's a whole lot of hype behind these cars, and just because they can go that fast doesn't mean they should be going that fast on roads that clearly cannot handle speed going that fast. So, and again, the car was not in the wrong at all, the machine part of the car was not... did not cause it to leave the road. It just lost control. Probably Paul Walker couldn't steer it right, but I don't know.
I mean, while we're talking about this, I just pulled up an article on Philly.com that was written back in July about a street racing crash that happened in Philadelphia. And it basically just describes the scene of the car had crashed into a tree. And according to this article, it's smoking wreckage so demolished that it appeared to be two vehicles instead of one. Limp, unmoving bodies lay on the ground, and a man covered in blood stood by the driver's side door.
That's terrifying.
Yeah. And this is right here in Philadelphia. It was a 2007 Acura, and the medics arrived minutes later and declared... some of the people inside dead at the scene. Two of the people were ejected on impact, and the third was heavily trapped and had to be cut from the wreckage.
It's just awful. It's so sad. And, like, this is an avoidable incident.
Yeah.
This isn't a bridge collapsed on someone. This is people decided to do the wrong thing, and it's sad to see every time.
Yeah, according to police in this article, they say that it was an area just behind Busselton Avenue Business Park. It is an area that has had street racing go on. The police know that it goes on, but I mean, that's one of those things that how do you prevent that?
Right.
I mean, you don't, like, because how do you make a law? I mean, the law for street racing is the speed limit.
Right.
I mean, it says, you know, this is 25 miles an hour. Go 25 miles an hour. That's how you prevent it. You can't make a law that says no. I mean, I guess you can.
Yeah, there's a law. There's laws against racing. My uncle got pulled over for allegedly race. He wasn't. But it happens. But I don't know. To me, you just go the speed limit.
Right.
I mean, everyone goes 5 to 10 over the speed limit, whatever. Go at a speed where you can handle the vehicle.
Yeah.
And you're not in danger of someone else not being able to handle their vehicle and you not being able to get yourself out of the way of that. So, I don't know.
Yeah, if you don't
First of all, don't drive. If the speed limit is 35, don't drive 95 down
exactly,
the road.
Exactly.
Okay? I mean, you don't know what can run out in front of you or pop up on the road or anything. There's a reason the speed limit's 35. Whatever anybody says, oh, yeah, go 60 down the 25 zone.
No.
Okay. All right. Look at you. But, I mean, it's a certain culture, though. Like, this street racing culture. I mean, if we went to any certain part of Philadelphia where it was a long stretch of open road, often they talk about the Roosevelt Boulevard being a location where this sometimes happens because it is a massively open just area of roadway straight for good chunks of where the road goes through Northeast Philadelphia. And there have been incidents there where, cars are flying down the Roosevelt Boulevard and a pedestrian late at night walks out into the middle of the road. They can't stop in time. Then they end up hitting the person.
Exactly. And you don't know what's going to happen in front of you. Like, I'm looking at an article from 2013. Street racer was flying down 80 miles an hour. And there was a mother and her two kids crossing the street. He plowed through them, killed them all, and he got 4 murder counts. So it says, the article continues, if the Audi was going 40 to 60 miles per hour, Mrs. Banks and the children would have made it to that six feet into the curb. The crash wouldn't have happened. Also, if he was going slower, he probably would have had the time to see them correct his behavior, slow down or stop or divert the vehicle. There's so many options. I don't know. I think a lot of the time we talk about stories on this show that, like, tragic things that could be so easily avoided just by showing a little bit of common sense.
Yeah, so, looking at an article in the New York Daily News, just continuing to talk about street racing culture here, it says that this is in reference to something that's going on in Hong Kong right now, that there are these street racing clubs that people join, and the article describes says the drivers huddle together to set the route always at the last possible minute. One of them spots the red and blue glare of police lights, and they scramble to their cars, regrouping a few miles away to continue the race. So concerned about preserving this, and they get up to, according to this article, they get up to 124 miles per hour, and they build these cars that are just absolutely just on steroids. And they go and do this in the streets of Hong Kong. And, this article says it's a global phenomenon from Los Angeles to Sydney to Kuala Lumpur. And that's true. I mean, we see it. We see it here. We're seeing it there. We're seeing it everywhere. So preventable, but something that is so prevalent that I don't think, in reference to this lawsuit, you can say, as a result of this, blame it on the car. I don't think that's something you can do. I think it has to be, let's take responsibility for what happened.
Exactly.
It was tragic what happened, but, he was going fast. He wanted to go fast. So, I mean, I don't know. Interesting to think about and to consider all the aspects, especially here in Philadelphia, since, I mean, it's prevalent. It's prevalent everywhere. I don't know. Just preventable stuff.
Use common sense, please. Yes. Please, please. If you're listening, if you're not listening and you're telling people, just use common sense. Be smart, please.
That's right. Please. That is what we want, common sense. That's what we will leave you with here on Rational Radio for this Tuesday. Hope you enjoyed the show. We had lots of great discussion today. We will be back tomorrow, 3 to 4, on WHIP, Philly's number one college radio station. Have a great day, everybody.